Namaskar once again to all the speakers here and a very warm welcome to this PSU edition of Technology Roundtable Leveraging Technology for Hybrid Work Environment. We had a very successful edition which was centered on the governance sector 2 days back, and today's this roundtable would be focusing upon the public sector enterprises. I am Krishna Mishra here from Elets Technomedia. Elets Technomedia is India's leading B2B media company and consulting organization. In partnership with Microsoft India, this is a pleasure and an honor to present this technology roundtable on the title Leveraging Technology for Hybrid Work Environment. Over the course of next 75 minutes, we'll be going through an initial talk by Mr. Namit Sinha, Head of Government Vertical in Microsoft India, who will be giving his perspective on this topic for around 10 minutes. This talk would be followed by an interactive panel discussion between different speakers from various public sector enterprises here, many Ratna Maharatna organization, their public sector heads are here, heads of their IT departments. After this panel discussion, there would be a very short and crisp presentation by Dr. Nitin Pranjape, founder and chief executive officer of Max Office Services, who will be taking us through a very engaging discussion on technology immersion enabling frontline workers. And then we conclude at 4:45. So once again, my very warm welcome and greetings to all the speakers here. Before we get into the presentation by Mr. Namit Sinha, a brief introduction of all the speakers. I welcome Dr. Balveer Talwar, Executive Director, HR and Corporate Communication in Bharat Heavy Electronics Limited. Dr. Talwar has over 37 years of experience at BHEL in diversified fields like HR, administration, strategic planning, business excellence, CSR, quality, productivity, HSE, and industrial engineering, etc. Dr. Talwar enjoys a distinguished academic career. He's a mechanical engineer with a postgraduate diploma in management. He also has a distinction of being the first scholar to accomplish doctorate in management from IIT Roorkee in 2008. A multifaceted personality, Dr. Talwar is a trainer, author, reviewer, career counselor, and a keen student of Vedic studies. Very warm welcome to this panel discussion, Dr. Balveer Talwar. Dr. Balveer Talwar will be joined by Shri Deepak Khanduri. Shri Deepak Khanduri is currently working as Chief General Manager Corporate Infocom Services in ONGC Limited. Deepak has wide experience in conceptualization, engineering, and implementation of enterprise-wide IT, telecom, and OT systems. Currently, he is in charge of IT governance in ONGC and drives the digital transformation agenda of the company. Very warm welcome, Mr. Deepak Khanduri. We then have Shri Mukund Hajib, Chief General Manager IT, Power Grid Corporation of India Limited. Mukund is an electrical engineering graduate from Jivaji University in Gwalior. He has worked in EHV substation construction and O&M as well as equipment condition monitoring laboratory. For the last 8 years, Mukund Hajib has been working at the ERP and IT department at PGCIL, where he looks after IT infrastructure, which includes data centers, networking, and end user devices. He also leads the in-house software development in Power Grid Corporation of India Limited. Very warm welcome to this panel discussion, Mr. Mukund Hajib.
Thank you.
We then move on to Shri J. Murugadas, General Manager, IT, Shipping Corporation of India. Mr. Murugadas has more than 3 decades of experience in the information technology domain and has spearheaded various challenging IT initiatives in Shipping Corporation of India. He is a postgraduate in statistics and holds a master's degree in computer applications. While managing various projects, he has also been instrumental in building a strong in-house talent pool to prepare the organization for its digital transformation journey. Welcome, Mr. Murugadas.
Thank you.
Then we have Mr. Abhishek Gaur. Abhishek Gaur is currently working as product owner, customer engagement platforms, Project Anubhav, which is a digital transformational project of Bharat Petroleum Corporation Limited. Abhishek has been with BPCL for the past 16 years and have worked in various roles, including sales and marketing across retail and lubricants business lines. Abhishek is an engineering graduate with an MBA in oil and gas management. Welcome, Abhishek. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
These were the speakers from the public sector enterprises from the industry. It's my pleasure to welcome here Dr. Nitin Pranjape, Founder and Chief Executive Officer, Max Office Services Private Limited. Dr. Nitin Pranjape is a highly sought after speaker and is famous for his witty, humorous and motivating delivery style. He has coached over 330,000 professionals and more than 3,100 customers across 18 countries over the last two decades. Microsoft has recognized his ability by awarding him with an MVP title, Most Valuable Professional title, for the last 16 years. He is also a change management consultant. His blog, efficiency365.com, has over 1,200 articles about work efficiency enhancement. Welcome to this panel discussion, Dr. Nitin Pranjape. And finally, the moderator of this program will be conducting the entire panel discussion, Mr. Namit Sinha, Head of Government Vertical Microsoft India. Namit has been working with the leaders in the IT industry for the last 24 years. He has a very deep and rich experience with government sales, telecom sales, and large enterprise accounts, and has handled many large, complex, and transformational projects and accounts across geographically spread teams. Warm welcome to this program, Namit Sinha.
Thank you, sir.
Now I request Mr. Namit Sinha for his brief context setting on this roundtable, Leveraging Technology for Hybrid Work Environment, before he moderates the panel discussion. Over to you, Namit.
Thank you, Krishna, and good afternoon, everyone. It is my honor and privilege to be able to sit with all of you here in this roundtable conversation with esteemed panelists like you all. I'll make a very small presentation in terms of what are we going to talk about here in this panel discussion, and then I'll open it up for a roundtable conversation where I would be asking questions and your perspective about the things which is relevant for your business, how you are seeing the technology is going to play a role in a setup of manufacturing companies like yours, and how Microsoft as a company can provide help, support, and what are we doing in terms of taking this engagement forward. So with this, Pooja, if you can just bring, the slide is up here. All right, so we are here to talk about how Microsoft can help empower the backbone of your organizations, which is the frontline workforce. So if you look at the manufacturing companies, they have always focused on product quality and innovation as a key differentiator towards going for their market and for their growth and journey as well. But what we have seen, the circumstances are changing now, and it's only product and innovation is not going to be key. They're also going to be business models are evolving. And as of now, they are also looking at how do they kind of engage the product excellence by leveraging the various workforce that they have within the ecosystem. So growing expectation on workers is going to be very, very key in terms of getting the skills within the organization. Expanding the customer needs is becoming absolutely critical, and how technology is transforming that customer needs, bringing that expectation into the organization by delivering and engaging the ecosystem is going to be very, very important. How are we trying to do the acceleration in the market? That market is, efficiency is increasing, and as of now, if you see the market, the time to market is becoming absolutely very, very, very critical. And the shifting of focus towards serviceability is going to be absolutely very, very key, because we are seeing the how quick and how efficient you are going to deliver the service is going to be very, very critical for the overall organization efficiency as well. And then how do you evolve the product offerings in terms of bringing more and more technological advancement, technological thing in terms of evolving the product, in terms of bringing in more products and more capabilities and deliver by delighting them with the new offerings as well. So these are the things that we are seeing which is going to happen into the marketplace. If you go to the next slide, please, Pooja. Okay, so now if you look at it, remaining relevant requires transformation across the organization. So the organization, if we are saying, as of now, enhancing digital factories to transform production is going to be very, very critical. Empowering the workflows to deliver a connected, integrated experience is going to be very, very critical. And empowering collaboration across the human centers through the manufacturing facility is going to be very, very critical. skilling the workflows is going to be very, very critical. And monetizing the connected workforce, connected products to create a new revenue streams is going to be critical. And how are people doing it? There are various work, there are various sections in the organization who need to be able to take a decision at the right time. So if you look at, for example, the boardroom, now the executives who are sitting in the boardroom, they would need skilling, they would need the knowledge, they would need the insights to be able to take a decision at the right time, at the right moment, in a very, very fast manner. They need to have the insight so that they can take a decision. The information workers, who are the people who are going to take a decision, who are going to be working around it, they need to have all the tools and they need to have all the information available at them so that they can take an effective decisions. And the frontline workers, who are the people who are going to be on the shop floors or in the factories, they are the people, they need to have the tools available with them so that they are able to connect, they are able to give insights, they are able to connect information, they are able to share information, and thereby they are able to help work towards delivering these services, delivering the output, delivering the things for the demand to meet the customer demands. So success means meeting increased expectation of the new normal. So because of COVID-19, we have seen there are some changes in a lot of organizations. A lot of expectations have changed from various organizations as well. And we are observing that about 71% want flexible work from home options. There are 69% want more digital upskilling. There's 70% of the population, the workforce, is expecting support for their mental well-being. And 80% of the employees expect their employers to ensure a better working world. So how this entire thing is going to work? And that is where the tools, which is the frontline tools, which is the connected tools, which is a platform, is going to be very, very critical for the entire ecosystem to be able to deliver the services. We have large references of many customers. There are some customers which are displayed here, but these conversations have beginning to happen in a lot of customers in the last 2-3 years. And pandemic has only helped increase these discussions going forward in the customer, because customers are now feeling the need and urgency to do these discussions absolutely in a critical manner. And that has become key for their success as well. So if you look at it, to modernize the frontline, which is becoming an absolutely competitive edge in terms of delivering these services, is going to be very, very critical. So basically, if you look at it, today, if you look at modernizing your entire frontline, the tools and the capability system and an organization can adopt is going to be very, very critical in terms of delivering the entire ecosystem. So you have to have, and that is what is going to be enabled. We are from Microsoft, and we have tools called M365. I'm sure we will talk about that more in detail again. But that is one platform, which is all in one mobile platform. It gives you, you can connect your team with one hub. You can engage with various people. We can engage at various level. You can connect with your team. You can manage your shift schedules more seamlessly. You can have a walkie-talkie. You can have people who can have a seamless integration at all levels. And then you can simplify the task of approval management process using creating a customized and role-based user experiences. So these are some things that is going to be very, very important. At the same time, you're also maintaining the security of the system. Because today, for example, the frontline workforce, there are a lot of companies in which there are huge amount of dealers and people that you need to interact with who are sitting outside the network. And they would be interacting with some social platform, and maybe there are some grievances which they need to write to, they need to get addressed to. But then they inform it and they mention, they share it on the social platform, which does not get registered and does not get responded at the right time. That creates some kind of a disruption, that creates some kind of a dissatisfaction in terms of their engagement as well. So today, in a secure manner, can you safeguard, can you have a platform which kind of integrates from all levels down up to the frontline level so that the information flows all the way up to the organization, and then organization can take a view in terms of how exactly you are making efficient and what all things that you need to do to make sure that you provide the right services. So I think it is important that you look at all things. And that is where we come and talk about the connected and engagement of the workforce. So now, for example, a single hub for teamwork, share, how are you able to share rich information to communicate efficiently? We have to have a hands-free and hands-up approach so that the communication can happen seamlessly from everyone. And how do you create deeper connections across your organization? How do you make sure people who are coming into your organization, how soon and how effective they are able to integrate and onboard? And how do you create an engaging and inclusive workforce? So these are the things that we are seeing is going to be driving where people are going to stay with the companies, work for the company, work for the success of their company and their organization. So if you look at these are the productivity tools which we provide as a platform, by virtue of which we are seeing a lot of acceptance of these particular tool in a lot of other customers, a lot of customers in a lot of manufacturing customers, where frontline is going to be absolutely critical. Because more often than not, we have seen the frontline is the one which is kind of the neglected lot, because you tend to take a decision at the board level, at the information worker level, but at the front level, you don't have connected tools so that it gets integrated right through and through. So for example, enhanced workforce management. You can manage the shift seamlessly, you can track time and attendance, you can simplify the tasks, and you have the power platforms to customize and extend the frontline platform that you want to deliver to your employees. So I think if you look at operational efficiency, these are the tools which will help you digitize the manual process. These are the tools which is going to help you in terms of your approval process. You are able to track your information, you are able to have one-stop shop for business application, and that is where I connect frontline workers for the customer so that they can get connected with the customers directly and thereby able to take decision which is more customer friendly, which is more manufacturing facility. And building everything because of M365, which is built on a very, very secure platform, building everything on a secure platform is going to be extremely key, because you are building the entire platform on a secure platform, which is going to optimize not only your cost, but it's going to protect and manage your endpoints by building a secure role-based experience for your frontline so that your friction is low in the experience, and then you are able to derive those services into the thing. There have been various studies which have been done by a lot of industry players, and I'm sure that's going to get that will be talked about Dr. Pranjpe as well. And that is something is the benefit that manufacturing organization like yourself can take and can leverage in terms of delivering faster product innovation, technology, and build everything together to deliver faster services. So that's what we are trying to talk about here. And our questions are also going to be around this area to all of you after I come back and do the roundtable discussion with all of you. So back to you, Krishna, for the next session.
Thank you, Namit. Thank you for that presentation. We are now going to start a panel discussion, Leveraging Technology for Hybrid Work Environment. As I mentioned in the beginning of this roundtable, we'll be joined by Dr. Valbir Talwar, AD of BHEL, Deepak Khanduri, CGM IT ONGC, Mukund Hajib, CGM IT Power Grid Corporation, J. Murugadas, GM IT Shipping Corporation, Mr. Abhishek Gaur, Product Head, CEP Project Anubhav BPCL, Dr. Nitin Paranjape, Founder and CEO Max Office, and this session will be moderated by, again, Namit Sinha from Microsoft. So back to you, Namit, once again.
This is a new thing that we have get to learn. All right, so welcome to this roundtable, gentlemen. And as I said, let me begin by asking questions to all of you and then get your perspective in terms of how exactly you have dealt with this. And that is the genesis of this conversation. So if I may begin with Mr. Murugadas, since the COVID pandemic, digital modes of communication and operations are no more a choice, but they are a necessity. Now, what technologies has Shipping Corporation of India leveraged to enhance productivity of frontline employees amongst this crisis? If you can just throw some light on that, please.
Thanks, Mr. Krishna and Mr. Namit. Good afternoon, other panelists and the participants. Thanks, ALETS, Technomedia, and Microsoft for this opportunity. A quick introduction on SCA. It's a Navratna CPSC in the maritime logistics sector, serving the nation for the past 70 years. It's a premium shipping line that owns and operates around one-third of the Indian tonnage. SCA has a national and international presence. Yes, as you rightly mentioned, pandemic has been a major disruption of this century. It has made us to introspect the way we do business. The new normal has made us all to realize the importance of adopting digital technology at the earliest. SCA somehow sailed through the crisis fairly well. Our challenges were multifold, Being a shipping and logistics company, our business outreach is global in nature. Hence, we were to handle the situation separately for the shore-based employees and the employees who are sailing on board the vessel. As a very first step, a very comprehensive business continuity plan was finalized and the action plan was prepared. And both shore and ship side, our CMD personally supervised the implementation. Application-wise, segregations were made and the employees were provided with remote login facilities to the ERP systems. And as such, most of the web-based applications were seamlessly adopted. However, for the core SAP, we had to provide them the remote login facilities. Okay, digital meeting setup has been established. As you said, the board meetings, seamless board meetings has to be conducted. Closing activities are to be performed. Okay, corporate level, most of the things have been taken care. Now the question is more towards the frontline employees. SAE made all arrangements for the shore-based employees to seamlessly connect to the work from wherever they are. But for the seafarers, we had to make a different set of arrangements. Since they are sailing, you know, like even the recruitment for them to come to the office and take the appointment was a challenge. So we had to build a quick portal-based solution for them to log in and then, take the appointment through that. And we are currently working on a cloud migration project and a collaboration and e-office kind of a solution. Our top management has set an objective as to have a nimble solution to work from anywhere kind of a solution. Okay, we are looking out on some mobile-based applications as well. So it's a kind of work in progress for us.
Sure. So great. I think great to hear from you, Mr. Murugdas. I'll come back to you again in terms of it will entail and how exactly you're doing. But no, let me just go to Mr. Khanduri. You come from ONGC and you have a huge amount of dealer networks also with you. So if I may ask you, sir, what productivity challenges did you face during the pandemic to communicate with your extensive dealer network? And how is ONGC planning on transforming its workplace with technology-enabled tools? If you can just share your thoughts around it, please.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Namet. Good afternoon to you and fellow panelists. The question put to Mr. Murugadas would have been more relevant to me. We don't have a dealer network, but then I can definitely talk about what we are initiatives we are taking in terms of can you please repeat the question?
So basically I was thinking, how exactly do you during this pandemic time, how do you communicate with your larger ecosystem? So if I can ask you or rephrase you around that, just let me know what are you are doing in terms of your connect with your extended arm.
Okay, so when the pandemic happened, the first thing to leverage upon was what is our existing technology base. And due to our foresight, some of the systems came in good stead, like one of the very basic systems, which we call e-office, known as Disha. All our decision-making processes, whatever we have, from MM to executive committee decision-making or any other decision-making, all are mapped into this tool. And once it was available from accessible from home, so our decision making processes were already up and running. So that was one, leveraged the existing tool. Other was our network. Network tools were also in place and we could quickly roll out our secure VPN based, various kind of flavors were there, IPsec VPN and TLS VPN based on the kind of connectivity people require. And so that was also up and running. And of course, SAP was there. Once all these where most of the business processes are again mapped. So once these are available to the employees were, up to 8 and our operations were running much smoothly. And definitely the tools which we acquired later on, especially Microsoft Teams for our video conferencing meetings. Now you cannot imagine that in one quarter, the peak video conferencing meetings that we had only on MS Teams. We had other platforms also like Zoom, and we have our own internal network where we have got MCUs, a 400 port high definition call and support with video endpoints within the corporate network. It also connects with other MS Teams and all. 30,000 meetings took place, 30 to 40,000 in one quarter. That only in one platform. So you can imagine the kind of collaboration that was happening, and that was required because most of our operations are in field, or most of our oil and gas operations are in remote offshore, where bulk of our production happens, that is in western offshore, and also across ONGC, eastern, southern, across the country and western region, drilling rigs and you can say production installations. So keeping those manned up and running was a challenge. And we created a lot of on-the-fly portals to manage to coordinate all this thing. And one thing which I would like to put on record over here is the massive queue change. When the complete lockdown was there, whole transportation sector was down. No train movement, no flight movement, nothing. And people in offshore, even young girls were there. They were locked there for around 2 months and more, around 3 months. Now to take them from that location and to transport them to their respective home, again, all across the country, it took a massive logistics and organization scale where chartered flights were hired and hubs were created, how people will move via road and coordinated through a portal where people logged in their requirements, and then all it was collated. And then, so that's how we took care of the productivity part of it. As far as field operation is concerned, IT productivity was already up because we are doing our operations through hybrid approach, minimal attendance in the data centers and rest through VPN and IPsec VPN, etc. So that's how we manage. And then more is there. Maybe I will chip in later what we are doing right now for furthering our digital agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Kanduri. In fact, that would also bring up to my point, and then I'll come back and discuss about that. Maybe I'll ask Dr. Paranjpe as well in terms of how you're connecting with your frontline. I mean, that's the key point here, because organization wise, we need to see how do we connect with the frontline, whether it is dealer, your own employees, your extended arm.
There is a very, sorry, I think I missed that point. There are two things over here. One is our internet portal, which is very busy and very extensively used, which is also having pages or you can say information from our top management. Then anything that happens in ONGC, the news is there. People can see that, any circulars, any guidelines, any change in policy, whatever. So, and it is being used extensively by all the employees, frontline, back end, whatever you may call, and it's accessible over web. So that means over smartphones, over laptop, definitely. And people get connected and are well informed through this portal. And other is, of course, the collaboration portal. We have Lotus right now, which is HCL. Collaboration portal is there where we have, communities, wikis, what have you, sharing of files, and the formal and informal communities are buzzing over there, and they do a lot of things because it's a large organization. Some geoscientific people are there, engineers are there, field technicians are there, maintenance is happening. So they have their own communities, share documents, etc., and even which is accessible to frontline, because till last mile, we have our telecom networks based on number of technologies through VSAT networks, through captive terrestrial wideband communication network. So that's how we remain connected.
Sure. Thank you for your insight, Mr. Kanduri. If I may come to Dr. Talwar, so you must be having to collaborate and work with multiple departments and thousands of maybe frontline workers, if I may call them, across multiple departments, projects, and maybe dealers as well. What are the issues that you encounter while managing the closed loop teamwork across so many departments? And how do you think technology could help or has helped or you think should help for an organization like you?
See, this is a very good question. The point is that the pandemic has taught us many new things. Though there were many disadvantages we have faced during this period, but the things like work from home was never heard in the public sector domain. We made the policies for that. In fact, we had just before the lockdown, we started e-office initiative. And it became very popular within a month and helped us in running the organization. Otherwise, I don't know how we would have learned it and followed it. So now I am seeing that on daily basis, at least 50 files are coming to me in e-office. to be cleared. And similar is the condition of other senior officers. Earlier, there used to be a bunch of files coming to you and you have to see each and every file, and then people are coming. Then the sanitation is the issue. But this thing has helped us to work from home, to work from anywhere in the world. You can work on it.
Mm-hmm.
In our HR, we already have a very good SAP data. And so all the attendance and everything has been monitored through it. But then in the attendance, it came that it should be touchless.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to change our attendance systems to make it touchless so that there is no further spread of pandemic. So that was another challenge. Now, we already have many web-based applications, but the use of these applications and need of new web-based application has increased suddenly.
Mm-hmm.
And we are working on it.
Mm-hmm.
Earlier, our management committee meetings in which CMD directors and executive directors are the members were happening physically. But after this pandemic, all such meetings have started happening virtually.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, for initial few months, the condition was like this, that you are continuing in the meeting for few hours and then you have taken the break for half an hour and then the meeting is continuing up to 11 o'clock in the night or so. So we had also learned in this period that how to bring the balance, because that has made the balance upset.
Mm-hmm.
Which people had earlier while coming to office. Yeah. Now, VC has become the order of the day. Almost daily, one or two meetings are happening on VC. Just before this meeting, I was having a meeting with all our units across the country on the celebration of Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav.
Mm-hmm.
So the things have become so simple with the technology.
Yeah.
You can sit along with the teams and discuss everything and come to the conclusions and take the decisions then and there itself.
Mm-hmm.
Which was earlier not a practice. It might be happening in the Microsoft, it might be happening in the IT world, but not in PSUs.
Mm-hmm.
So those things we have learned. We have framed work from home policies also, which was not there, then fine-tuned it. We have made other policies also to bring the flexi working timing. Then the communication has got a very big breakthrough.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have made the WhatsApp groups, and these WhatsApp groups are covering entire organization. So any message on one central WhatsApp group given, within a few minutes, it goes to entire population, including all the frontline workers, everyone, because everyone is able to see it on their mobiles.
Mm-hmm.
We are able to clear the files on our mobiles, access our emails and all the files on our mobiles and working on that. Then the social platform has become very important.
Mm-hmm.
And we have used these social platforms, and sometimes we organize the Excel award function for the people who have done the wonderfully in the organization and did excellent work. The awards are being given by the minister. So those functions also we have organized in the hybrid mode.
Mm-hmm.
Some people are called physically and all others, entire organization has joined on the web. So the point is, this phase is changing, but the places where we cannot implement it or we could not implement is, like, we are a big engineering and manufacturing organization.
Mm-hmm.
So as far as engineering is concerned, designs are concerned, that can be done. But when we have to do the manufacturing, you have to go to physically on that machine, you have to load the job, you have to place the cut and take this. So that thing is to be done. Then on our sites, people have to work on the site, otherwise it cannot happen. Because there we do not have any IT tool. IT tool can be used only for the some MIR kind of things, some communication kind of things only. Some training, we have made lot of training modules also. And in record number of training programs have happened during this pandemic era. So in general, technology has helped and rather forced us to learn it for survival and to run the organization. Otherwise, it would have been very, very difficult. As far as the workforce is concerned, we have to look after more than 31,000 employees across the country. Besides that, there are large number of contract workers working at the sites. So how these people are getting vaccinated? What is so I was just going through the data which I had received just before the meeting, that till today, how many people have been getting the second dose of vaccination. So I'm finding, except for one sudden reason, almost more than 83% employees have already taken the second dose of vaccination. So like this, the information is coming directly on our ESS system and using the SAP and other technologies. So it is really very good. And it is going to take the more innovative steps to make it practical for the future to come. Thank you.
No, very well said, sir. In fact, no, I'm very glad to hear that you are using some of the technology, though it's in different different forms of uses. In fact, of some of the thing which is you mentioned about some social media, it's while it's not integrated, technology is kind of enabling that kind of user friendliness in terms of bringing everybody together, getting out in such sites. So I'm very glad that all companies like yourself are using. Now, the next thing we have to discuss, you talked about some of the manufacturing and what interventions can be done. Look at the technology, there are a robotic process automation, which is also coming in place, which is going to help aid some of the automation in the even the manufacturing sites as well. While can it completely move away from current manual to a robotics? Maybe the answer is no, it will still take some time. But I think technology is kind of providing that help and support in terms of providing that capability to technology, to manufacturing company like yours, in terms of getting everything together. And how secure the technology can help provide those tools to you so that you can do this seamlessly is the need of the hour. So with that, let me bring Dr. Paranjpe into the conversation. And if I may ask you, Dr. Paranjpe, would you want to share some of the Microsoft vision in these areas of enabling employee productivity and closed loop teamwork between employees, the frontline staff, the dealer networks, and the entire ecosystem? Dr. Paranjpe?
Yeah. So thank you all. I'll be brief because I'm going to cover a lot of things in my session. But the main thing which I'm seeing, which has happened across and due to COVID, is the traditional barriers in every context have broken down, and we have had to take a unified approach, because traditionally we could say people who have a formal desktop laptop is one category and people who are always on field is a different category. But that itself dissolved because everyone is probably working from home for a significant amount of time. So all the traditional ways of handling people from a technical as well as productivity point of view have completely probably dissolved and reformed in the new world of hybrid. I'm sure all of you have gone through it. And now that we are coming out of it slowly, this is a good time to relook at what happened and which of those best practices which evolved by trial and error maybe, can those be made standard operating procedure for future with or without COVID? It doesn't matter. And that is the biggest thing which I think has come out of this entire episode. And while you are explaining your infrastructure and your initiatives, I'm also taking notes and I will cover specific topics in my session later. In terms of Microsoft platform, the only thing I have noticed during this is many people accelerated their cloud adoption, either in wholesale manner or in pockets, doesn't matter. But again, that's something you have to extrapolate and see, can it be expanded on a larger scale?
Thank you, Dr. Paranjpe. We'll wait to hear from you as well. But with that, let me come to Mr. Abhishek. And I know you have a large dealer network anyway. So with the proliferation of internet, mobiles, and social platforms, what are the changes you have experienced in your customer expectations from BPCL? And how can technology enable your frontline workers and distributions and the distributors that you interact with to meet these expectations? If you can just share your perspective on that, please.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Namit from Microsoft, Mr. Krishna from Elite. Thanks for providing this opportunity to participate and be present with the eminent leaders across the industry. So thanks for that. I represent Bharat Petroleum. I'm currently working in a digital transformation project, Project Anubhav. So coming back to your question, just before that also, Mr. Namit, so when you presented your deck in the beginning, I could relate to each and every slide, right? Uh-huh. And I think the question pertains to the second slide, right? Empowering workforce. And to us, BPCL as being the oil marketing company, yes, workforce is extremely important to us, and we have very large workforce in terms of dealership, distributorship, our field offices, our refineries, depot installations, and petroleum products being in the essentials during the pandemic. Also, it was running as usual, and that was the need at that time. Now, as far as empowering of the workforce through the technology during that time, I would take just one example where, as you understand, that petroleum refinery cannot be stopped or shut down like that. So, but it was very important that pandemic does not reach inside our campus, and wherein we are forced to take some shutdowns. So we at that time used the technology and introduced a tool, I would say, wherein customer can put their orders. We have provided them a portal. They can put the order there. We have provided a portal to the transporter, which is a link between customer and us. So he can assign lorries, vehicles, and we have made the system arrangements at our refinery gate also, so that the entire process, I would call, is seamless and paperless, more importantly, so that we can avoid the interaction, the physical interaction, at the best possible. That is one thing. Then coming back to our field force, our own officers, we introduced a CRM solution. Okay, so thereby reducing their physical interactions and also providing the 360 degree view of the customer. So I'm not getting into the marketing side as of now, but the whole idea was reduce their physical interaction, or time can be better utilized. The whole idea was that, and giving them the 360 degree view of the customer. And on the other hand, we also build a platform for the customer to have the 360 view of the company. Your precise question, is there any change in the expectation from the customer? Yes, there is. And digital transformation is in the air. It is the need now, right? COVID has only preponed it. I would say otherwise it would have come, 5 to 10 years down the line in our country. But COVID pandemic has preponed digital transformation, and it is everywhere. Now it's a need. And customer already, they have experienced the experiences like Amazons of the world. And due to pandemic also, they wanted to, have everything available on a mobile app or a web portal, where they can experience or interact with different organizations. And thereby we built this solution. But that I would say that is still a level one. Now there is level two. One is you need to have the platform or the portal. Second is you need to have a comprehensive one. Your customer is not interested in, you know, having installing various applications in his device and go to different platforms for different requirements. And so that is the expectation which has changed from the customer. And that is we are catering through our super app. We are doing business across various business lines. So be it petrol pumps, LPG, industrial products, lubricants. So that is where in the Hello BPCL, which is the which is our app as well as the web portal, we have come out with to, you know, meet the customer's expectation. And his customer's expectation is precisely convenience and personalization, moreover. And that is what we are trying to offer it to him. So come to our portal and you can interact to BPCL, whichever business you want to.
Thank you, Mr. Abhishek. I mean, great insights. I mean, great to learn the things that you are doing in your organization in terms of adopting the technology to bring more efficiencies for BPCL. So I'll come to you again. But if I move to Mr. Mukund Nejib now, what productivity challenges did you face when pandemic hit? And how did this impact your taking decisions timely for Power?
Thank you, Mr. Namit. Good afternoon, all panelists. And of course, Mr. Krishnaji. I think I have a almost similar story as Shipping Corporation or BHEL or ONGC or even BPCL. Though we don't have much public interaction, but our work is basically falls under essential services. So you see, the field work is again transmission line maintenance or say substation maintenance. That certainly cannot be done from home. That whatever that frontline worker is there, he has to be there in the site. And fortunately for us, most of our substations are such that the maintenance staff and the operation staff, it resides right there in the same premises. So actually much effect was not there, but the decision making body, that is our regional headquarters and our corporate center. We have basically three tier structure. We have a corporate center where we have around 1,000 people. Then we have regional offices, 10 regional offices. Around 1,000 people, 100 people per regional office you can consider, and then we have around 264 substations. So where you will find right from unmanned substation to a substation where around say 40-50 people are there. So that is the basically range of the offices what we have. And certainly whatever the officer people are there who actually don't have to work in the site, as our regional headquarters are there, or for example, our corporate center is there. So these people were really the ones which were affected because they were not able to go to office. And we were really fortunate that it was so that most of the time, I don't know how it happened, but most of the key things we were already on some or other way in a setup which can be, which could be easily extended to work from home scenario. For example, e-office, so I mean, I think most of the people talked about, again, Power Grid has implemented e-office in 2018. And we had, we were already giving it through VPN to senior people. And when this thing came and when people were not able to come, then we were able to extend it to all the executives immediately. And we were really lucky that our firewalls and our underlying network was, we did not face much of this bandwidth issue and all. Then second thing is, of course, SAP. That is the name. In fact, that is the most important business application what our people use. That also was already available on VPN. And the another thing which we were, which was affected mainly is basically the construction activity. Because there, because the construction activity, there we faced some problem. But still, the approving process of that, it did not get affected because we were so lucky that just some time back, we had installed, we had in fact put in place this engineering drawing approval system. Because what happens whenever a project is awarded and all the drawings and all the contractor has to submit, earlier that process was entire physical. So contractor person will come with the drawings, he will submit in our engineering department, they will put up in their approval process, and there is an approving channel there and approving authority. Then once it gets approved, then the drawing with the category, it is conveyed to the contractor, then some drawing he has to resubmit, all this process is there. So all that workflow as well as those drawing repository, all for all that we had implemented one engineering drawing management system. So that proved to be very handy. Mm-hmm. So at least that part did not get affected. So other than that, of course, we had a lot of VC infrastructure, traditional VC infrastructure with on-prem MCUs and all. But of course, it had limited facility for connecting from outside. So there I have to really thank Microsoft, because they were so kind enough to provide us with the complimentary Microsoft team licenses, and we were able to give that extend those facility to all our executives. And now what has happened is people in fact have started enjoying, and they have got used to that. Earlier whatever they were trying to do through physical meetings, now in fact even after the lockdown and all is over, even now they prefer to do that. So this is in fact, we face more problem of once the office started, because now you see what has happened is when it was lockdown, everybody was at home and they were trying to connect meeting, and also they were all connecting to through Microsoft servers. They are Microsoft Teams. They are talking. But when they come to office and then they started interacting with Microsoft Teams. So now all this traffic has to go through our internet link to Microsoft servers. And so obviously we started facing problem with our LAN. Of course, not minor problems we faced with the LAN, and for example, corporate LAN, we had some problem. But even there, fortunately, we were already in the process of upgrading. So we upgraded our LAN infrastructure, and we enhanced our internet links, and that has really helped. Another issue which we faced was our particularly corporate center. So many people, most of the departments, they keep their departmental data on a network drive, which is shared within the teams. So that is basically shared by Microsoft Share. So we were not able to really extend it to houses. So in the sense for work from home scenario. So what we had done is we had gone for a cloud storage, platform we already were using. So whatever critical data is there, people wanted that we shifted to those cloud platform, and then people were able to collaborate. So this is I think more or less I have covered most of the things. So this is what is our experience as far as this pandemic and post-pandemic. Of course, we are not out of pandemic, but when I say pandemic, I mean the lockdown period and post-lockdown period.
Yeah, so thank you, Mr. Mukund. I'm glad to know we could also provide some assistance to you during pandemic, and we could help you provide the technology. But that is where the point of discussion around providing, you talked about many things. You talked about how technology is helping you connect with your various people, how you were able to efficiently connect and through the Teams channel. The collaboration entire platform, if you are able to get a secure line right up to the home there where you needed to share with your people. And that is where technology layer would be able to provide that capability for you to be able to be more productive. And obviously those challenges like network upgrade, they were inevitable. You had to do it anyway. Yesterday or today, to happen. So thank you for your input, Mr. Mukund. If I come back to you, Mr. Murugadas, there must be a large number of first-line workers that you would be dealing with. If you could just let us know, for example, from a service and operations perspective, who would be bringing a lot of things, a lot of insights to you for your customers as well. Now, how are you envisioning this disrupting this industry in respect to technologically empowering and the last mile workers or employees that you have? How exactly, if you are able to integrate that piece, if you can just share some thoughts around that, please.
Okay, as I was mentioning earlier, like most of the speakers have also, panelists have spoken, we have somehow managed in all respect with the existing technology and to added on top of it. Like you mentioned, very categorically that the solutions are scattered, data is scattered, information is scattered. Now, how do you bring it together into a single platform where the utilization of that right from starting point to the decision-making point has to be thought about? In our case, we split it into two work profiles. They basically I mentioned about it. Like one is the people who are on shore, who are supporting the office. And the second set of workers are from the team is from the vessel. Like that's like a floating factory. You know, if we talk about a factory, an entity which is there on shore is different from the entity what is floating. So we have around 100 odd vessels. So the challenges are slightly different over there. Generally, we need to provide a good connectivity for those people who are sailing on board the vessel, because they are away from the family and they need to get connected nicely, and they should have a good work environment. So the first preference for us is to enhance the network connectivity on board the vessel, which is on. And second is using IoT for integrating our devices and the machineries on board the vessel so that the controls can be done from here, from the office. So we have kickstarted a couple of pilot projects on that. And of course, collaboration has to be done. Now we'll have to start working on that area. As you mentioned in the beginning itself, or your slide is also mentioning about it, the security has become a big concern for all of us, because the data, humongous data, is getting generated from all quarters. Of course, we are planning for cloud migration and all that. So we have to have a clear-cut plan towards our endpoint security. Okay, if you're providing good infrastructure and tool to the ground level workers and to our agency network, let's assume, with good application support, then comes the security, wherein we need to have a good network as well as endpoint security built in place. So it's going to be really a work in progress, and it has to be progressively taken to the next level.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you, Mr. Mogudas. With that, let me get Dr. Paranjpe into the conversation. For us, it's a big learning moment for even an organization like ourselves in terms of some of the transformation that we have seen with our customer and by the way, our own transformation as well since COVID hit. And as Abhishek also mentioned, we have seen 2 years of digital transformation in maybe 2 months. That's where we are all in. So Dr. Paranjpe, if you could share the learnings and experiences that you have seen across organizations on digitizing their frontline workers. And so to you, Dr. Paranjpe.
Thank you. So as I said earlier, due to COVID, everyone became a frontline worker unless you are physically on the machine or manufacturing something, which probably went down for some time. So that segment called frontline worker, which was generally marginalized, became frontline, whether you like it or not. Everyone practically became a frontline worker, and frontline is a misnomer. We were nowhere near frontline. We were sitting at home, struggling with connectivity. You can't suddenly ask for an IT person to come and do something. So as IT people, I am sure all of you will agree with me that whatever we have been struggling to adopt in terms of technology at user level, majboori mein ho gaya, lekin achha hua. Because eventually people have to work. And that majboori now is becoming a habit, and that's a good thing. And that is across industries, across countries. Sitting at home in this same chair during COVID, I have done 300 sessions across 9 countries. And there is a universal thing that acceleration which happened is great, but we can't just sit on our laurels. Use that momentum to now structure things, put things in the perspective. And the most important part I would like to say is, although everything has been brought into action with valiant effort, most of it, we didn't get enough time to think and strategize and optimize. Now is the time to learn from the learnings and put it in a cohesive manner so that duplication of work, multiple sign-ons, multiple connectivity mechanisms can now be consolidated, and the transformation continues at the faster pace which we have already achieved. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Paranpe. Very well said. And maybe very quickly, I think we are almost on time. But if I can just ask Mr. Deepak Khanduri to just share briefly, what do you think a company like Microsoft can help your organization in terms of your digital journey? If you can just share a few things, maybe it will be helpful.
Yeah, surely. First, as I said, that Microsoft is already helping us. We have all Windows environment, MS Office, Office 365, MS Teams. We are a very large user of MS Teams. Well, that's that. And now going ahead, as Mr. Paranjpe also said, that we have to keep this momentum on. But as you might be aware, that because you are a technology provider, but for companies to absorb technology, you require right kind of people and culture. Mm-hmm. If you are trying to compare a very mature organization, how frontline workers are using their connectedness for their own enhancing productivity, that may not be easily or directly or immediately translatable to an Indian context.
Yeah.
But we see that, and there is a path we are working on. There is a, we have set up a BCO, that is Business Center of Excellence, where we have hired a reputed consultant, and we are engaging with him very intensively. We having a relook at all the domains, which covers frontline, which mostly frontline. Our ENP is entirely frontline. How we can introduce digital technologies to improve our, lot, basically for cost saving, time saving, and productivity increase. That's the first target. And in that, Kitty, there is definitely a role to enhance personal productivity, where Microsoft and the likes of you can be very useful. So we are working on that, and some of the initiatives we have listed, and then we definitely will reach a point where we will be directly contacting you for helping us and enabling us in our further march.
Yeah. Sure. Thank you so much, Dr. Khanduri. We would look forward to those interactions as well. Quickly coming to Dr. Talwar, since you come from an HR background, so if you could just let us know quickly, what is the role of technology to impart knowledge and training across the entire, maybe factory, your delivery and the last mile staff or the frontline workers if in BHEL? Dr. Balveer Talwar, please.
Repeat the question.
I'm saying, what is the role of technology to impart knowledge and training across the entire factory or the project delivery in the last mile staff that you have for BHEL, the frontline workers?
See, as I said earlier also, the role of technology is very critical for imparting the knowledge, because until and unless we are not making the people to feel what work they have to do by digitization, it will become all the manual kind of learning and traditional kind of learning environment, which is not going to sustain in the current environment.
Mm-hmm.
The major thing, like if I have seen in many factories, especially in the automotive sector, where what work they have to do is getting displayed on the computer screen, that this operation has to be done like this, and then they are performing the operations like that. These things are not available in the mostly in the manufacturing industry elsewhere in India, except the automotive sector.
Yeah.
If we can make the people, similarly, another thing which is very, very critical, if we compare with the automotive sector, there multi-skilling has been done. One operator can run four kind of machines, but in our engineering industry, it is not like that. If they are running one machine, they are not willing to go to another machine to work, and neither they are willing to learn.
Mm-hmm.
It is because of the, not because of any technology, but because of the mental barriers we have created.
Mm-hmm.
So these things need to be taken care of, and we need to change the work culture, which is really very critical, and technology can help us in a great way to achieve this.
Sure. Thank you so much, Dr. Talwar. Very quickly, Mr. Abhishek, if I come back to you, you talked about your dealers, you talked about interaction with your frontline workforce as well. So from your extended frontline staff like dealers and the distributors, what are the change in their expectations in terms of digitizing their manual process? And do you want to share any learnings and use cases with us?
Yeah, sure, Mr. Naman. So as we discussed, there is a change in expectation from customers, and so do it from our channel partners. So dealers, distributors, definitely, they are also moving towards digitization, and they are expecting, you know, that solutions are provided to them, digital solution, which will enable them to perform their business more effectively. So I'll take quick one or two example to put my thoughts in perspective. One, like in case of retail business, petrol pump business, right, where we have one loyalty program for the transporters, right? So there, from the dealer side, so we have provided this digital platform to for the customer to enroll, to, you know, recharges to their account with money and spend it for the fuel purchase at various ROs. Similarly, our dealers are, you know, dealers, they have their own arrangement of extending credit to the transporters. And they expect that there should be some tool through which they can manage their, you know, credit transactions with the dealers. And so that we have provided the entire credit management module to the dealers, where he can track what amount and he has offered to the customer and when it is getting due, similar to the credit card, I would say, right? So these are the expectations which are coming from the network. I would take another example. So in our lubricants business, what happens whenever you buy a pack of lubricant, there is some coupon inside. And typically what happens, this pack through the chain of distributor to retailer, ultimately it reaches to the mechanic, right? What used to happen then, mechanic pull out this coupon and again through the same chain, it will come back to us and there he will get the reimbursement. And there's a lot of manual processes which are there. So that was the expectation from our distributor network. They said, you come up with a solution, and so did we. And we provided this solution, whereas now on the fly, mechanic can scan the coupon and within seconds he's getting that gratification instantaneously in his bank account. Yeah. So these are a few examples where we are saying that yes, network is also expecting us to provide them digital solution, and so we are doing that.
Yeah, great insight, Mr. Abhishek. Thank you very much for sharing that. And if I can come back to you, Mr. Mukund, if you could share a few examples on the challenges that your department faced in the last 2 years in terms of enabling seamless information sharing across various workforces that you have, from factory to delivery to last mile, the way you call it.
Yeah, Mr. Namit, actually, we don't have any factories. As I told, we have substations and lines.
Yeah.
So, but still, what main problem we found is the user at the end, he's attached to his device. Somehow we have to de-link him from his device. So we are just thinking that probably we should think of some VDI-like solution with VPN so that we can let him have his data and as well as the applications on those VDI machines. Because what happens now is we are not able to stop the user from actually saving his files in the computer. So when such situation comes, it becomes a problem to him because he is at home, then he will not get the files. Okay, if he has put it on cloud, that's all right. But many times, though the facility is there, people will tend to put in local drives and then they don't get it. So that is one thing we were just thinking, ki probably we should think of some VDI solutions, which will this one. Second thing we had, the problem is that most of our machines are traditional desktops. So we were not really equipped that from each desktop, he should be able to do the video conferencing or virtual collaboration. So that is another thing which we have taken care. And of course, like I told, the network issue what we face, that all the people, 10 people or say 100 people are sitting in the office, they are conducting meeting, but all traffic is going to internet. Probably there even people like Microsoft also have to come up with something which will say act as a satellite server sitting in probably in my data center instead, so that at least this all data, 10-2 people collaborating just side by side cabin, and their data is going all the way to internet. Probably though we are very much moving towards cloud, but these things, of course, there are edge computing like things are there, but I really don't find them for this. So this is one thing I feel something can be done about.
Thank you. Sorry, go ahead.
Then another funny thing what we faced here is, because now everybody is doing meeting, so there is a lot of crosstalk. So that is one funny, this one, that we have to encourage the culture of using earphone or headphone with mic. So that's a human part of it, actually, of course. So of course, and security and data protection also becomes very critical when you are allowing people to work from home and giving them access to all the data.
Yeah.
So I feel these are the few things which I would like to bring to the panel.
Thank you, Mukund. Thank you very much for this. In fact, no, these are very relevant points. In fact, no, it quite echoed with all the points that made by various speakers in terms of how do you make sure the data is safe and secure, because that's very, very critical. And especially, in fact, that brings to the end, but I would want Dr. Pranjpe's view on this. If you could, like, we often see this last mile workers are using unsafe consumer apps for communication, manual process. Many people talked about it. Manual processes for data collection and collaboration. We are collecting from a non-secure environment, which is outside your office networks, and you're bringing that data inside your office. How exactly that data collection and collaboration is going to work? And their onboarding and learning needs are often undeserved. So I think, how can Microsoft play a role in terms of improving the security framework for these workers? And why should PSUs, consider this right now? And what is the benefit that companies like we all have the panelists from benefit? So Dr. Pranjpe, if you can just summarize around this, please.
Yeah, sure. I'll cover that in a little more detail during my session, but just to give you a brief summary of what I'm saying is, like some speakers I already said, the hard coding of login, device, app, that relationship cannot work in a hard coded manner any longer. Not only that, we have many more apps which got developed suddenly with a very fast turnaround time. So we need to look at faster application development and integration services while maintaining security, compliance, and privacy, irrespective of whether the person is using personal device, is in a cafe, in a shop floor, or somewhere offshore. And that is absolutely possible, and I will cover that in my session. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you so much, Dr. Pranjpe. And I think with that, we come to an end of this roundtable, but I think I would transfer it back to Krishna and maybe Dr. Nitin Pranjpe for you to share our M365 solution. So back to you, Krishna.
Thank you, Namit. Thank you for this wonderful moderation. In fact, the discussions were so engaging that we have overshot the timeline. And this always happens whenever the discussions are engaging. Anyway, I would like to invite for a very short session by Dr. Nitin Pranjpe, founder and CEO of Max Office Services Private Limited. He will just run us through a PowerPoint session of, I would request Dr. Nitin not to take it more than 10 minutes.
Yeah, so I'll be very brief and very fast because all of you are very experienced people. Only few notes and mapping points which I've discovered during this discussion, I'm going to touch upon them. All of you have already been using Microsoft in various shape and form, so I don't have to tell you what Microsoft is about. I'm not from Microsoft, by the way. I'm a gynecologist by qualification. For 15 years, I did hardcore IT. Then last 15 years, I'm focused on improving end user efficiency. And why did I do that? Because all the type of work we do comes in two flavors, structured and unstructured. And right now, as I said, practically everyone is a frontline person in that sense. What happened in this era of COVID is every department has a efficiency improvement target, whoever you are. That was going on incrementally, but suddenly that happened exponentially. Everyone woke up, whether you like it or not, you woke up, and we have taken measures to address the issue in a very structured, unstructured, ad hoc, whatever may be the manner. but end result is success. Now, when we talk about frontline, what are the issues? Well, we start at the leadership level, then we have management level, and then we have large number of staff all over the place. All this is known. What is not looked at in the entire discussion is whatever work we do, whether you're a leader or middle management or lowest level person, the work in the IT context is in broad two categories, structured work and unstructured work, which is what I was talking about. As all of you are engineering oriented companies, I don't have to tell you what is efficiency. All of you know what is efficiency, but in the context of unstructured work, what is efficiency? Because in manufacturing, you want to produce more goods, you have to increase the input. Whereas in the case of unstructured work, which we as users do, what is their input? The input is person, human effort, our precious life. So the idea of all Microsoft products is one simple principle. Your effort should be less and your impact should be more. And that's, if you understand, imbibe and apply this, then you will get enormous transformation without writing a single line of code. And most probably many of these components all of you already have. The problem which IT faces, especially when it comes to unstructured work, is that it is unstructured. Because it is unstructured, it has never been attempted to be optimized. Unstructured does not mean the output is wrong. Unstructured means it is inefficient in the sense the outcome is correct, but you are taking extra steps or time or energy, which is a waste of everyone's life. So core work, office related work, 50-50% time jata hai roj, 3-4 ghanta to what Excel PowerPoint hai. This part we are perfect at, we are improving it continuously. Whereas this part, as long as the end result is achieved, nobody really cares how it was done. And if you focus on this, then you become super efficient. Now, in the context of frontline, I have summarized all the contexts and challenges which people have already mentioned, and I will just summarize those technologies. Basically, we want secure collaboration. Obviously, it came out, and we want instant communication. Whichever tool is seeming to be feasible at that point of time, we have already adopted. Fair. Data capture analysis, it always keeps growing. We want task delegation and monitoring, because a lot of work which was personally monitored is now being monitored online. And all of your workers probably are already in shifts and there is a system for time management, but some outsourced contract workers may not have that. And then process automation, which already you are experts at. But when it comes to process automation also, there is a structured part of process which is well documented. It has already come to IT. IT has already taken steps, but there is a lot of unstructured process which is going on. So this all is diverse, but if you just broadly look at all this is happening where, then you will be surprised. We are talking frontline workers who are your representatives, either direct employees, contractors, outsourced agencies, but they represent you. That's not the only boundary. We also have to empower people externally. Your other dealers, distributors, suppliers who are not your employees, even indirectly, but you have to work with them. And all this interaction crisscross is happening in an unstructured manner. So what are the, I know you are from different industries, different complexity, different challenges, but there is some commonality. When it comes to unstructured work, these are the common needs. Everyone is creating something, we have to store it somewhere, and you get the idea. So all these components, there are no hardcore systems which are created from scratch. That is where Microsoft is very strong at. So if I want to show you these components and map them to Microsoft platform very quickly, I'll just use one feature of PowerPoint, which is called Morph, which will just put these into the correct slots and you will understand what is the platform. Many of these components you already have. The problem is at user level, even if you have the subscription, many people may not know that these components are available. As IT, if you try to teach people, they may not be willing to learn because they are saying my job is anyway getting done with Word, Excel, PowerPoint. I don't have time nor inclination to learn more. But why did Microsoft create? All of us are IT people. We know a feature or an app is not created because the vendor has nothing else to do. There has to be a use case behind it. So all these are use cases which are already implemented. before you develop an app, it is absolutely important to check what is the offering, what is the potential benefit. These are solutions. So as IT, we are taught from use case to solution. Fair, you're already doing that. These are solutions. Look at these solutions and discover your needs behind them. That way you get immediate impact and it's pre-integrated. So to give you an example, Teams, all of you are using, but let me just take a step back and give you an example of how unstructured work happens and where is the potential for improvement. I'll take an example, any kind of work you can take. This is teamwork. Even though I as a finance person know how to create a budget, in order to actually create the budget, which is just one task for me, I will have to send some emails to get data. Some people I'll do meetings with, some people I will send files to, some people I'll call for clarification. I'll get some data. I'll copy paste, create a draft, send the mail to boss. Boss will give me some iterations. Then we will have a final draft. Then I will call all stakeholders for a meeting and then the budget is done. So one task translated into 15, 20 different activities using 17 different apps. That is called inefficiency. Is it familiar? Yes. Is it specific to government? No. It is a global problem. So when everyone has a disease, it's not called pandemic, it's called normal. And that is what has happened with unstructured work. We just got used to it and nobody's complaining, but Microsoft did one very important thing. We can't eliminate email, meetings, files. They are components of work. But why have so many apps? That's why Microsoft created Teams. And even customers who have been using Teams from all sectors, all countries, have not utilized it fully. So like all of you have said, chat and video calls are already going on. Great. But when the meeting is over, what happens? You may have noticed, and maybe some users have cribbed about it before, that what happens after a meeting is over? Any software, meeting is over. They click the end button, meeting is over. In Teams chat, you can chat with people or groups, of course, but when a meeting is over, it lands in chat. Many people have not noticed it. Those who did notice it did not like it. But then why is it happening? Because when the meeting is done, any software you use, there is a start meeting, end meeting button. When meeting button end clicked, everyone goes home. And nothing to be done? Of course, there is something to be done. All this is not the job of that meeting software any longer. End meeting. Teams says no. Why do you want to waste time and send mails to each other and reply to all? Do that in chat. So the cultural shift which we are talking about is post-meeting collaboration should happen in the context of the meeting, in the meeting chat, which continues. That reduces thousands of mails floating around every day. Less effort, more impact. Now coming to project management, for example, project means what? There is a large common activity to be done with a set of people who is the team, typically cross-functional, multiple vendors involved, and there is a deadline. All of you are experts at that. But every project doesn't go on MS Project or Artemis or Primavera. There is a lot of unstructured work around it. So I need to keep everyone informed. I send a mail every day to 14 people and the same thing others are doing. So simple calculation. Thousands of mails are coming to you about each project over a period of time. This is mail from that project only, various aspects. And this is just one project. All of you are a part of multiple projects plus regular email. Where is this going in a dumping ground called inbox? Whether it is a Microsoft inbox or Google, doesn't matter. Inefficient. So what is the problem? Does everyone want to be inefficient consciously? Absolutely not. But let's find the root cause. What is the root cause? Is inbox the problem or projects the problem? Neither of the above. The problem is inbox is always one and projects are always more than one. Using the wrong tool in the wrong place is the problem. Why did we do it? Because earlier there was no choice. Now there is a choice. The choice is stop using inbox and create a separate team for it. The moment you do that, see the before after difference. I'm a part of multiple projects. I want to know what is happening. The only place I can go to today is inbox, search on it, and then I get thousands of results. Compare that with Teams where without searching, I get separate compartmentalized output. I don't even have to click on each project, only the Android project. More effort, less impact, less effort, more impact. Like that, every component of Microsoft is designed to follow the simple principle of less effort, more impact. And from an IT point of view, what happens is you're already automating things creating apps. Some are on premise, some are homegrown, some are purchased. Software as a service, all that is good. But there are a lot of manual automation which is happening, which is under the radar. I wouldn't even call it shadow IT. It is formal work being done on random files, emails, chats, approvals. How do we manage that? Because even that comes under security, compliance, privacy. So that is where these three products come into picture. Power Automate is by itself doesn't do anything, but you can tell Power Automate, look at my inbox. I'm going to get 20 quotations. As soon as the RFP ID matches, detach the file and put it in the procurement team automatically. Otherwise, I would be doing it 20 times. Now, IT doesn't need to be involved here. This is zero code. You just teach people what is available. They will tell you use cases. A normal course of time, they would have thought it is my job. Everyone is doing it. I shouldn't even tell IT because it's too small a requirement. Agreed. Instead of overloading IT, empower people. They can contribute to automation because they are the persons who know the use cases best. So that's one aspect. The security and compliance part, assuming you have some part of Office 365, I strongly urge that you tell people one thing. Everything which is official, people say, send me an email, right? They will not accept boss telling them on WhatsApp, give me 20% discount. Why? Because official means email. That's legal evidence or it'll help you in litigation. Why is that so? Everyone knows we archive email for whatever number of years. And if there is a litigation, there'll be a legal hold. All of you know that. The issue is, if there's urgent requirement, I can't wait for someone to respond. Now that is where the important thing comes into picture. Because if it is not urgent, I would use email for this purpose. What if I want faster response? I have to use chat. And then if you use any random chat, which probably you can't avoid beyond the point, but you have to educate people that if you use Teams chat, none of these apply. Because when you use Teams chat, exactly the same rules, regulations, retention policies can be automatically applied. So now you have to actually create a poster which says urgent official chahiye, mail mat mango, Teams chat mango. Now, less effort, more impact, more resilience, no extra effort, no programming. So that's what I mean. And from a security, compliance, product and productivity point of view, you must see these three numbers. If you have any component of Office 365, these numbers are available to you. Only you can see them. Monitor those numbers because they're not just numbers. Why these numbers are there based on your environment, your configuration, your data, your posture. This is a live thing. It changes every day based on what you do. And how do you improve the scores? Very easy. Below each, there is a improvement actions available under different categories. And detailed actions are available with weightage, which you can prioritize. And individual action gives you exact steps. And if the integrated platform is there, then many actions can be performed automatically. And before I finish, probably you have already done it, but if you have not, please, I request all of you to enable passwordless two-factor authentication for everyone. See the number, touch the number, you're done. If you do that, people will thank you because they no longer have to remember complex password. They don't have to change passwords, but your security improved. And because you have so many apps, please explore single sign-on of Azure AD. Any kind of application written on any platform, you can integrate with a simple Office 365 login, even if it is on premises. So that is another thing to explore. So with that, I guess I will hand it back and I will just show you a summary slide which will indicate which tool to use when, because when there are too many tools with overlapping features, it does become confusing even for IT. So we have to give authoritative guidance to people. And we were talking about adoption and how people are purchasing a lot of technology, but people are not using it. The step-by-step process for this change management, where IT and HR and top management has to come together, it's a four-step process. Traditional thing doesn't work. The top management has to know the potential of the platform being fully utilized. It can transform efficiency beyond your imagination, independent of COVID pressure. So we create awareness at top management level. Now with Teams, we can educate everyone because one Teams live event, the capacity is 20,000 people. So you can have 15 events, all your staff is covered wherever they are. They just need a browser and a mobile. So train everyone, at least create awareness at every level. And there are thousands of features unexploited. So find champions and then explore things potentially proactively, map them to business context, gamified by creating standard operating procedures, and these champions will give you long-term benefit. And as an example of what an SOP would mean, because you know what are SOPs, but in the context of efficiency improvement, here is an SOP, which tool to use when. Ad hoc work, not urgent, send mail. Nothing else, you should send mail. That's the first step. Urgent ad hoc work, official mail, non-official chat. Project with multiple tasks, don't do it on group chat. Create a team and do it there. Shared task list, don't create it in Excel. Put it as a planner inside Teams. And open communication from top management with transparency and interaction. Don't do it on intranet. Intranet is typically read-only. Do it on Yammer. And then complex projects with linked tasks, assignments, variances. Of course, you need a formal project management software. So like this, if you educate people, they will come back to you with much better compliance adoption, and they will come out with use cases which IT on their own can never think of. So it's a win-win situation. So with that, I will end my session. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Paranjpe. Great insights and taking us through those great tools and technologies which can enhance the productivity of the frontline workers. With this, we come to a conclusion of this PowerPack panel discussion. Temples of Modern India, as India's first Prime Minister has referred to, or India's public sector, they are truly on a path of digital transformation. And as most of the speakers agreed also, this digital transformation might have been preponed by COVID pandemic, but this was always in the coming. Now, as mentioned by Dr. Paranjpe, it's a time now to consolidate, to strategize, and to optimize the momentum gained so far. So with this, we conclude. But before the speaker says, time permits, in case any panelist has got any question for any one of you, we can spare another 5 minutes. Otherwise, we are through with the panel. Any questions, anyone?
Yeah, I have a small query for Mr. Abhishek. I was seeing his credentials. It says product owner, customer experience management. So I just wanted to know what his role is and under whom it is this initiative, or whom does he report to? That would be great if you could share that.
All right. So, as I said, digital transformation is conceived in BPCL some 2 years back, and we have an entity called Digital Business. And this digital transformation project's name is Project Anubhav. And Project Anubhav have different themes, okay, different initiatives, I would call. But the customer-facing part of it, that is customer engagement platform. Okay, customer engagement platform covers, you know, both the application app part of it as well as portal part of it. So whatever customer facing initiatives we are doing under Project Anubhav, so I am leading that. And I am reporting to Mr. Rahul Tandon. He is head Project Anubhav.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Any other question, Namit, any other speaker from BHEL, ONGC, PGCIL, Mr. Murugadas from SCI? Any question, anyone?
No, I just want to thank everyone. Thank you very much, all of you. Thank you very much for sparing your time, being with us. We are here with you for your digital transformation journey, and we look forward to having more interaction with all of you individually and as well as together in a forum like this. Thank you very much. And last but not the least, thank you, Dr. Paranjpe, for great insights and great insight in terms of solving a very complex problem in terms of what to use where. You showed in a much efficient in a layman's term in terms of what products and what tools to use where. So thank you very much for those insights.
Thank you, Namit. Dr. Balbir Talwar, if you are still around, sir, this certificate, a small token of gratitude from Millets Technomedia.
Thank you
for so coming here, Dr. Balbir. You have been a regular speaker.
Thanks.
You have been a regular speaker at Millets Forum. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Deepak Khanduri, Chief General Manager IT, Oil and Natural Gas Corporation, ONGC.
Thank you.
This next certificate, a small token of gratitude from Elex Technomedia for Mr. Mukund Hajib, Chief Thank General you, Manager IT, Power Grid Corporation of India Limited.
Thank you, sir.
We then had Mr. J. Murugadas, General Manager IT, Shipping Corporation of India. Thank you, Mr. Murugadas.
Thank you very much.
We had Product Head Customer Engagement Platforms, Project Anubhav Bharat Petroleum Corporation, Mr. Abhishek Gaur with us. Thank you, Mr. Abhishek.
Thank you.
Then we had Dr. Nitin Paranjape, Founder and Chief Executive of Max Office Services. Thank you, Dr. Paranjape. And finally, the moderator of this entire panel, Mr. Namit Sinha, Head of Government Vertical, Microsoft India. Thank you, Namit. Thank you once again, all the panelists here.
Thank you very much.
And look forward to interacting with you in next Elex Forum.
Thank you.